thank you all for being here. I'm really excited about this topic for a lot of reasons. Security is such an important part about the blockchain space, but really it's a very important part about technology in general, right? So I think we'll have some great conversations here. Why encryption is important in traditional tech, and then why that matters in this blockchain.
Pen testing is, for those that might not know.
Pen testing is short for penetration testing, and that is when an attacker or a tester tries to break
the defense. Good evening, everybody. My name is Carl Weaver. I am a Greater China, India, Asia wireless market mobile device specialist, and for the past decade, I've been in mobile payments and mobile device security. I work for Rivets Corp.
Awesome. Cool. So my first question for all of you is, what is your password? I used to joke when I was...
Your private keys, because we will have all kinds of private keys, and they all need to be stored in my particular ecosystem, the mobile device. So you're actually storing private keys right now, and they're actually exposed on an Android smartphone. They're exposed right now because there's no protection for them. But we need to take control of that and store and have a sort of key management of our private keys and take control back from the Zuckerbergs. Can I say that? the Facebooks, the Googles, because there is no privacy and there is no security on various mobile devices. And we have the technology to take back control.
So what about the argument?
Oh, my wife, Mary. They're going to look for that and they're going to say, oh, Mary, 1960, blah, blah. They are just using that and also phishing for any kind of information for you. I tell my daughter, who thinks, oh, Dad, look at all this stuff is free. I'm saying this free to a certain point. Your privacy is the most important thing, and it's not free right now on the internet and on your mobile device. And the goal is to take it back. Yeah. To take it back somehow. I think Apple does a great job. I think Apple does one of the best jobs in the market of trying to secure your privacy, identity, and security. And I think Apple Pay, does anybody use Apple Pay?
Yeah.
It really is good, and it works, and it's not been cracked.
Yeah. Brandon, what do you
on
think?
On currency that particular country has, the more centralized the use of a digital asset or a digital currency will be.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think China's proving that, right? In the sense of like how the manipulation of someone's information can be then used against them, right? Like, so I actually just saw on LinkedIn today, someone was that lives somewhere in Asia was bragging about how his company verifies when people are going to work, and it's literally just facial recognition as people are walking through. Right, but there's a social credit score in Asia or in China, and it can have, you know, that's probably a great example of what can happen when things get taken out of out of the way that it probably should be for centralized. So when we think about data, what's to prevent even on a blockchain scenario that from being manipulated or controlled?
Well, I think that
the likelihood of you wanting to send that
for example, 10 p.m., no transactions can occur. 6 a.m. in the morning, no, I'm not even up at 6 a.m. in the morning. You wrap these permissions and policies around the key, and that's part of the key management. When you do that, you have a better safeguard.
Like a bunch of incidents and not statements.
Very much like that, and then you can guarantee that I certainly did not send that transaction at 6 in the morning, and I can attest to that because I have the transaction record, and you can have all of that data authenticated and verified through various means of key management. You can. That's how you would solve it. Yeah. Otherwise, we're going to, with the advent of the blockchain, we're just going to introduce more fake news being introduced to the blockchain. That's the problem.
Right. So, Reza, let's get into the penetration testing a little bit. So, you know, you might have a super secure, a data store, but what happens when the front end is the entry point? You know, how do you prevent against those things? Take us through a scenario where something like that happens.
Absolutely.
India.
Yeah.
Everything was on his laptop. His wife said, I don't know what he's doing.
Yeah. So that's, yeah.
These are all secrets, but making a way that they can actually, manage those.
Well, one of the key problems that we're going to continue to experience, not only with these $1,000 iPhones, is the fact that people want to steal your smartphones for your crypto. They don't care about the phone to make calls. They want all the crypto on the phone. We've created something called social key recovery, and we're using something called the trusted execution environment, and we're actually spreading, or we're splitting the keys, but we're also spreading the keys amongst your own personal additional devices. Most of us have an iPhone, some of us have a tablet, some of us have a notebook and a PC. Well, we can spread the same keys across all those devices, or if you want to try another approach, we can spread those amongst your friends and family so that if the smartphone gets lost or falls into the Pacific Ocean on a fishing trip, you can still recover those keys through the key management apparatus or part of our network. That's really, really key because people do lose their smartphones. People do have their smartphones stolen or just on the street, rough and, places like, maybe New York is not, it can be dangerous at night in New York. It can be even more dangerous if people know you've got lots of crypto to steal on your smartphone. Your phone becomes the magnet, not you, the phone, because it has crypto. So we are able to manage the distribution, the splitting or spreading of those keys. That's what we're doing at Rivets, and I think it's very, very cool. We're not the only ones doing it. I think lots of people get it, and they're trying to do similar things. There's lots of activity going on with key management, lots of it.
No,
it's very, very different because the problem that we have today is our keys are stored in the open, naked operating system of Android. Apple does it a little bit differently, but Android is open source. And most consumers today don't even realize that their keys are naked, they're crypto private keys or any kind of digital assets, are naked there in the open operating system in an app. And it's easy for a hacker to infiltrate it with or without malware. It's easy for them to infiltrate the device to steal that information, usually private keys. So we use the trusted execution environment. And the trusted execution environment is a very interesting technology on every single smartphone on the planet. It's also on most of the tablets. And it's such a cool model because the trusted execution environment doesn't require you to go knock on the door of T-Mobile and say, T-Mobile, I want to give security to my users. No, the trusted execution environment, all you need is the developer tools to know which smartphones you want to protect. And then you can very cheaply get those developer tools and you can protect any single app on an Android smartphone. You don't need to talk to the chip vendor, you don't need to talk to the operator, and you don't even need to talk to the handset manufacturer, because that's the job of all those guys, because they're all in the ecosystem. Their job is to make sure that this technology is open and ready for access. The problem has been third-party developers put security last. Sorry to say that. I'd like to propose governance, and I have not just fallen off the Looney Tune train here, but I believe that, like the United Nations, everyone plays by the rules of the UN. We do not have that in the entire technology ecosystem, hardware, software. We do not have that for our engineers. Whether you're a software or hardware engineer, we do not have that right now. And so we also have very little ethics training for what is right, what is wrong. Who wants to go to the dark web today? Okay, we don't have any of that. We need that. That's not my job. I'm not even an engineer. But I believe that we will have a leak and somebody cracks it, patch crack. It's job security for people who are in this industry. You won't see an end to security breaches unless you have a governance. And by that, I'm thinking of a United Nations type of governance where we make sure every single engineer, certified as an engineer from a college university, must undergo ethics training, number one, and number two, gets a national ID card that I'm an ethically trained and I'm ethically trained and I vow to the governance of providing security and privacy to the citizens of my country or of the nation or of the world. We don't have that. We need that United Nations-like approach to security. Otherwise, in 10 years, I've listened to more than 1,000 companies talk about, I have this security, I have this security. We're not going to solve this unless we dig deep down inside ourselves and think, we are really the ones to blame. You can't blame technology for being invented. We're the ones who are abusing it, actually. Did they need to really push it out like that when a woman died? And God rest her soul, there's no way to justify a death because we want to push technology to the limit, right?
Mm-hmm. So how do you think we should establish that kind of covenant? Because I completely agree, I think ethics are essential, but what do we do to set up that kind of United Nations like
approach? I think it has to start with the mobile network operators. Any of them here today? I think it needs to start with them because everything evolves on basically the internet, in this case the mobile internet. In this case, who governs that? The GSMA? Yes, but the GSMA manages that with the entire mobile network operator ecosystem in the world. And really, they're the ones who should be setting the standards. And really, we should be asking them to give us to tell us why they have the best security, because I guarantee you, when your crypto is stolen on your smartphone, your Android smartphone, you go back to the operator, they're going to say, I have no authority. I'm sorry. Then you go to the handset maker and say, not my problem. Then you go to the app developer, not my problem, and it's lip service all the way down the pipeline. Yeah. It has to start, I feel, with the network operators, because who else can it start with? The GSMA, perhaps. The GSMA pushing it down. The GSMA has pushed it down. It's the operators who, it's all money. They aren't implementing the security that is actually needed. But I also fear that if we have too much security, we limit the development of technology as well. So it's a double-edged sword.
Now this sounds a little bit like Richard Stallman's kind of apocalyptic view.
I'm not a politician.
Everyone has to be a licensed coder, and there's like, you know, processors only run licensed code.
Nobody would use that stuff, right?
Yeah.
It's a fine line. It's a double-edged sword and a fine line. But for sure, when it involves the safety of a human being, I mean, like these autonomous vehicles, and look at the whole issue with the Boeing planes.
But look at the issue we're in right now, the software industry, is that, you know, it was given kind of a free pass because it was such a new thing, but there's like no liability, there's no warranty. Every piece of software you use has no warranty.
It's outsourced to the, software is being outsourced to the planet. Maybe not North Pole, but maybe. and we don't know where it comes from. We don't know what hidden malware has been. We don't know about the hardware, and we don't know about the software.
And the externalities fall on the individuals. Like, the companies reaping the profits, but the externalities are falling on the individuals who are dealing with the effects of these data breaches.
Okay. Your DNA, your heart, your eyes, even your voice, these are all biometric parameters that can be measured. When you take one or more of them and you compile them together all at once, it's very difficult to spoof.
Right.
Such a thing all at once. You notice now the airports around the world are using thumbprint, but thumbprint.
It's only so secure.
It's just a piece of software, guys.
Absolutely.
It creates an algorithm. It's a piece of software.
And your voice can be faked. I mean, like we've seen like so-called deep fakes, that this is a real thing that is happening now and it's going to continue to happen. Like, we need to make sure we're looking at multiple different sources.
Yes, but yeah. But the, and I agree with both of you, I'm just saying that storage of that information, once you've created the biometric algorithm, it's nothing but software. It needs to be stored in tamper-resistant hardware.
Completely.
And that's what Apple does, yeah. And that's what all the other companies need to do. And they also need to use a two-factor, that kind of two-factor authentication. But two-factor authentication by itself is not secure. It's when it's put in a tamper-resistant container,
yeah.
What we call a secure enclave. That's when it's really secure.
I think your point about hardware is absolutely crucial, Carl, because, I mean, it's not just online that we're getting attacks here. We're seeing hardware attacks as well. And so it's crucial we do that.
So what's your opinion?
A little bit further?
Sure. Biometrics and hardware embedded into myself.
That's what Apple does right now with Apple Pay.
Look at the chip in my finger.
Oh, you're talking about
embedded hardware.
In your body. I saw a guy with an NFC NFC chip in his wrist, and I just said to myself, man, that's a painful way of proving technology.
I think it's going to happen. I mean, like,
it is going to happen, but I hope I'm not around when it is.
There's a company in Europe doing it now. There's guys that go to work to replace the badges. You know, they have their chips.
I just wonder, quite honestly, I just wonder if we're losing touch of humanity when we're trying to combine inanimate things into our body. I can see the value of a pacemaker. Absolutely, we all can. It saves lives. But to prove a point that I can touch a point of sale system and buy my Starbucks coffee because I've inserted it into my wrist, I think it's going a little bit too far. We are that is the Matrix. I'm sorry.
Reza, you've done a lot of work with medical devices. Have you looked into that much?
Right, yeah, so.
And my humble opinion, it's better not to embed it into a person, but get it standardized on a mobile device. Just think about this. Think about this topic. eSIM. Does anybody know what it is? Have we seen it in this country? We've only seen it from Apple and Google. Well, that's because various other handset manufacturers, their governments, their mobile network operators said, eSIM? No. You know, it's killing my data pipe. It's a bad business model. I don't understand. I'm not going to make any money. This is really powerful. When you can standardize a new technology on a mobile device, and on all of those mobile devices, you ensure the scaling of that technology all over the world when you can get it on enough mobile devices. But when you can't, like in the situation with eSIM, it should be on every single mobile device now. It is not. I started pushing that from 2016 until 2018. Why isn't it on all mobile devices? Because the operators said, this kills my business model. I don't understand the business model. Hence, we only see it on the iPhones. And when you ask the operator, hey, how do I use eSIM? Wait a minute. They get it. So the smartphone, I think, is putting it on the mobile device rather than in the body is probably a better solution to scale a technology. Your goal is to sell things, and it's better to scale it on the device because that device, your arm, you can't cut it off and ship it to the world, but that mobile device can be shipped all over the world.
It's around kind of the, you know, who makes them, the, you know,
interesting.
Who secures the enclave, you know, if they're being used to secure keys, that's like in a sanctioned,
so,
for a sanctioned use case, like would the person who secures that enclave be responsible, you know, and how
good
do you
question.
Think that would kind of affect that usage of it?
So, the company that actually owns the entire wireless industry is not an American company. It used to be a British company. It is now a Japanese company, and they own Sprint. Does anybody know who I'm talking about?
SoftBank.
Bingo. SoftBank cares about security. SoftBank owns ARM. 98% of all the chip technology that goes into our smartphones, our tablets, or even our smart TVs comes from ARM. They are instituting high levels of security. But it really comes down to who ultimately can manage my data is the company that can secure my data. Who can secure my data the most? The company that owns the mobile apps processor chip, because every single, that's the bare bones of the entire ecosystem, the mobile apps processor chip. Who owns the IP? ARM. Who's ARM? Well, it's owned by a Japanese company, an ally. Okay, that's great. Who is actually doing the manufacturing? Actually, that's Taiwan, another ally. That's a good thing. I think the real key is the company that owns where the secure enclave and where the data gets put into the secure enclave is going to be able to dictate out to the entire ecosystem the rules and regulations. And that's not America. I'm sorry to say, that is not America. Whether we know who they are or not.
So one last question.
I'd say 90% of all the semiconductor IP chip business for the server technologies, which a server is a server, whether it's a cloud, whether it's a RAN network, right? And actually, Intel does use something called SGX, which is essentially the same thing as the Trusted Execution Environment. And I have seen companies implementing that technology in the servers. Again, we need to demand, push it down to the mobile network operators, push it down to the hands. We need to demand that our companies that provide us these devices, whether it's a server or a smartphone, we need to demand that they've got the highest level of security. And in this case with the servers, SGX, Intel does. And actually, it is being implemented. But we as the end consumers, we need to ask the tough questions. We need to ask them, so how come my Apple Pay is secure? Explain why. You talk to a salesperson, they'll say, sorry, next customer. You need to get to people who can really articulate why it's secure. And we're not at that phase yet, but we're getting there.
Carl's right. The bottom line is we need our platforms and we need our hardware to be secure by design. That just needs to be the standard. I would say where is the tech you're using, the hardware you're using, where is it being made? I think thinking about that is something that we don't talk about that much. It's something that's worth considering.
Cool. Awesome. Well, thank you, everybody, for being here. And let's give our speakers